Now every gambler knows the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away, knowing what to keep. 'Cause every hand's a winner and every hand's a loser, and the best you can hope for is
right,
to die.
Here we go. I'm here with Keith. We're doing our final wrap-up episode because we did fall 1910, and then the game basically is over. We had these Galicia disband, North Atlantic disband, Black disband.
Did they draw or no?
They did this move in spring 1911, and they drew.
Wow. Final board that draws.
So it ends at 10-7-7-5-5. If you notice, England lost Holland. England could have lost Moscow. Turkey lost Naples, but got Tunis. And everyone agreed to draw, which I think was the right play because no one was going to stop Austria from here.
No. It was a good game, and then it was a bad game. I think the point that lost it was, why would England ever support Sevastopol? I think that was the end of any competition whatsoever.
And not just that, tap Tunis.
Yep.
As
like England
and tap Belgium. So I'll give you a little inside info here, which is I have an interview with Turkey that will drop soon. And Turkey tells me that he, England, France, and Turkey worked out an arrangement to where this is what it was supposed to look like in winter 1910 with this series of here.
So that's without them supporting and tapping.
And it didn't turn out to be that. England was supposed to give up Holland, was supposed to go to Tyrrhenian, supposed to help Turkey into Sev. And if that had actually happened, this is a competitive game.
Yeah. Even if he didn't give up Holland, there was no reason to help Austria in the south at all.
Now, it's not a competitive game for England. England's at six. I mean, the only growth England has from this position, I think, is to stab Germany. So I understand why England did not go along with this. But by doing what England did...
Yeah, but I mean, even if it held Holland, it would have been at seven still. And they made that bad play about not bouncing Sweden. I don't understand that at all.
Well, yeah. I mean, Sweden was just supposed to stay there, but didn't. And so... this is what they sort of had agreed to that it would look like, and did not come to fruition. But if it had, even if England was at seven and Germany six, it's a playable game.
Yep. No, England threw this bad.
But I think England prioritized him being second, which is what he had, over him being third or fourth. And I don't know if I blame that.
It just depends on if there's any reward in second place.
Yeah. I mean, so, all right. I mean, look. The truth is, it ends in 1910, as all extended deadline tournaments should end. So,
yeah, right.
I really want to credit Austria's play. I think Austria is a deserving winner. Played it spectacularly. Played people off each other. Got the growth that was needed and held off Turkey after the stab.
Yeah, I really like, you know, how Grayson played Austria. I wonder. I would like to see him play more, I guess. I know I've seen a few of his games, but it feels like there was just a lot of bad players around him that just could not get together. Or a lot of good players that are just really off their game.
Well, Tangian, the other thing I gleaned from my interviews, and I wanted to spare Tangian another interview, A, because I don't think he really likes me, and B, it's been a lot of play for Tang, so, you know, he can take a break here. But what Andre really complained about was he just wasn't available. Now, that could be a tactic, but the way Andre sort of put it was he was just embroiled in so much diplomacy that he wasn't around to communicate, so that made it difficult for Andre. Like, Andre's point going all the way back to 01, is he didn't even know Andre was going to put the fleet in Tunis. I mean, Tang was going to put the fleet in Tunis. So no one told him. And he's like, if I had known that, I would have bounced black. Would have played it differently. I wouldn't have had to get the fleet out like that. So
yeah, really. Tons was burnt out and he didn't play very well.
Yeah.
I don't understand putting the fleet there if you're not gonna pressure France either.
Yeah, well, that was another dynamic that they all talked about, which was there was just a generalized board sense that France and Italy were not gonna fight.
Shouldn't, unless France is under severe pressure and it looks like there's no jug. But
yeah. And Evan and his Germany sort of confirmed that everything was a stab. Like, there was nothing where we saw England move into a center, like here, here, or sorry, here, and another time.
the Ruhr
here. That was all England jackaling.
Yeah, I feel for him just because it's like you need to work with them, but you can't work with them, and it's an awful situation.
Evan admits this was a mistake here. His concern was getting embroiled down south with England, who kept stabbing him. He thought he could get Belgium. You know, he's just looking for Dot. So, you know, I hear you. Andre confirmed that he basically just mentally was done at this point, still trying to work with people to win, but it was very difficult. But overall, I think it was a good game for Olympus. For the season one, had some good players. I signed up for season two, and we'll see how that goes.
Very proud of Ewok being able to not collapse. Yeah, he got attacked relentlessly the entire game.
Two ways to look at it, right? Which is, Evan was very complimentary of Greg saying he was selfless. Well, Greg, I'm like, well, he would have been selfish if he had more dots, but he never gave it to him. But he never got off the ground. France never got off the ground because of his partner.
They ended up on seven. That's actually not too bad.
Tied for, or actually third place with the tiebreaker. But having just come in third in the Summer Classic, I'll say third is good. You know, nothing wrong with third. All right. Any concluding thoughts on the game?
I mean, had England not supported Austria, I mean, seven would have been a pretty commanding position. So I don't know. It started off really rough, and then it got competitive, and then it just wasn't. After that, after England made that those series of plays, it was unilaterally Austria's game then. So I don't know.
England basically dictated it, but I think England just prioritized second over being first, which I understand.
It felt bad, then it was exciting because it's going to be good. And then it was a little anticlimactic at the end.
It's okay. I'm glad it drew because I was tired of covering it. not saying I won't cover the next season two finals, but hopefully I'll be in the finals and have an excuse not to cover it.
Well, I'll see if I can stop you.
All right. Well, are you playing as well?
Yeah.
Dude, I'm going to fucking kill you. I'm telling you right now, if I'm in a game with you, I'm attacking you.
Why?
I've never for fun. Just for fun, Keith. Just for fun.
I'm going to get everyone else to attack you. That way I can be your savior for a change.
Good. I'm going to get everyone to attack you. Then I'm going to call a draw a sick. All right. Look, hey, thank you for doing these. Thank you for your steadfast commitment to the Diplomats and our ongoing coverage of games only very few people are interested in. But it's been a pleasure, brother. Thank you.
Always a pleasure.
For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done.